Praise the Lord, everybody. Praise the Lord, everybody. Everybody, just know that the Lord has made, amen. Amen. Let us rejoice and be glad. And would you go on and stand to your feet and help us do some worship this morning and welcome the presence of our Holy Spirit. Amen. Look at your name real quick and just tell us, good to see you today.
It's good to see you.
Come on, look up and tell us, good to see you today.
It's good to see you.
And then look at somebody else and say, whatever God has for you today,
whatever God has for you,
don't miss it.
Don't miss it.
Amen. Let's worship the Lord. Make sure everybody got that message.
Last week, you guys did an amazing job. Everybody stepped up to the plate and kept welcome you here at Father's Tabernacle. If you are new to the building, the bathrooms are upstairs through the doors. There is coffee in the bag. If you need anything, please see anybody else in this building because we are all part of the family of Father's Tabernacle. Good morning.
Amen.
God, my
word, you let me catch my breath and send me in the right direction. Even when the way goes through Death Valley, I am not afraid. When you walk at my side, your trusty shepherd's crook makes me feel secure. You serve me a 6-course dinner right in front of my enemies. You revive my drooping head. My cup brims with blessing. Your beauty and love chase after me every day of my life. I'm back home in the house of God for the rest of my life. Psalm 23, the message.
Better.
Dear Heavenly Father, your grace pours over us today, taking away all our impurities. We praise your name as we revel in your love. We can feel our soul shining as we turn our faces to you.
Yes.
Please let us soak in the promise of eternal life in you as we feel it penetrate our body to the very core. We want to carry that promise with us always. So as soon as we close our eyes, we can sense your Holy Spirit wrap around us, holding us safe. We ask it in the name of your precious Son, Jesus Christ.
And man, it continued on, and I told Paul I wanted
to share with him something in private later, but how when you listen to the voice of God, how the testimonies that establish from that word follow days after, and I'll tell you that you definitely hit somebody's heart this week. And part of their story to me was in the text message, I was bummed when I got to church and realized you weren't preaching. It's how they started their message off to me. When I got there and realized you weren't there, it was like, oh, man. And then the rest of the text message just blew me away that I wasn't supposed to be here. And so it was pretty cool how that played out. So I simply bless God, amen, for that. Amen?
Amen.
And, it's so good to be home. Happy New Year. Everybody's the first New Year that we've, first Sunday of the New Year that I've had a chance to see my people. Amen. We still have some light chairs, but we still bless God for that. So we certainly bless God. But I did not get an opportunity last week because I was not here to sing happy birthday to Miss Lillian and Pete. And so you thought you were going to escape, but you are not escaping, especially since I get my kiss every Sunday. That's the only woman that's allowed to kiss me and my wife not get mad. And I would not miss the opportunity. And then I heard that India's birthday is this coming Saturday, so maybe she's listening. And if she is, this is for the three of y'all. Happy birthday to y'all. Happy birthday to y'all. Happy birthday to Miss Lily and Mr. Pete in India. Happy birthday to y'all. Every Sunday we come in, man, and I always look for certain people around the room. And I share this in private with Mr. Pete. And Mr. Pete is one of the biggest encouragers, and he always makes it a point. We have our own pack up here at the altar every Sunday. He whispers something to me, and then he turns around and he walks away. And it's just an understatement. It's understood. And that's something that I hold treasure and dear, because over the last year, that has meant more to me than anything else has. And for his dear wife, every Sunday, some people say, man, she talks. She's a talker. She loves to talk. But I tell you what. Every Sunday that she's here, she does not miss walking past her pastor and making sure that I get my kiss on the cheek, and tells me how much she loves me. So I pray the blessings of God to follow y'all. I pray that this will be the best year of marriage you've had, more peace, more joy, more excitement.
Yes.
And I just pray and declare that, you know, we get older in the years, but I pray that you get younger in heart. And that's my prayer for y'all this year. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. For India, who's a mighty warrior to the kingdom.
Yeah.
And a labor before God and a giant to be reckoned with. And I pray that this will be the year that her voice is heard, not just locally, but that she will start to take assignments where God will cause her to travel, and her voice will be heard globally. Amen?
Amen.
And God is using her mightily at such a young age. And I just believe that God is going to take her higher this year. That's my declaration. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. So let's preach a little bit. If you listen to what I preached last Sunday, then you're going to be a little bit disappointed today, because I believe that was a word for Virginia, but I believe it's a word to get us as a foundational word to get us launching forward this year. And so if you would travel with me for a few moments to John the 11th chapter. John the 11th chapter, we're going to start at verse 38 is where we're going to start from. Those of you guys, as you turn into that no word of prayer, many people have been catching this bug and this virus and all that stuff. I called it on Tuesday, and thank God it was only a day long for me, and I haven't been doing great since then, but my mom has caught it, so she's not here today, and so she's not feeling too well, so keep her in prayer. And then other people around the congregation have been coughing and different things, and they're not here as well either, so that bug is traveling, so keep people prayed up, amen? And then those of you guys who are first time visitors, I see a couple in the room. I pray that something has already been said. I pray that somebody has greeted you before you got too comfortable. And if they haven't, let this be your greeting for me. I'm happy to see you. Miss Alice, she called me the last two Sundays. What time does service start? And so it blessed my heart. And she told me last week when she called, she said, everybody's been telling me I need to come and visit. So I want to come. And so I bless God that people are talking about Father's Tabernacle. Amen. And they have purpose there. And then because they're there sitting back in the back, he's sitting back there. And every time I go to TL's, he makes it a way to come out from the back. and makes it a way to always come out and talk to me. And so he has finally pressed his way. He told me for a long time he was coming. And so I bless God that he is here with us today. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Sean, it's good to see you, man. And so let's preach John 11, verse 30, a very familiar passage of scripture. It says this. It says this. Jesus, once more deeply moved, came to the tomb. It was a cave with a stone laid across the entrance. And he repeated these words. He said, "Take away the stone," he said. But the Lord said to Martha, the sister of the dead man, "By this time there is a bad odor, for he has been here 4 days." Then Jesus said, "Did I not tell you that if you believe, you will see the glory of God?" And verse 21 says, "So they took away the stone. Then Jesus looked up and he said, 'Father, I thank you that you have heard me. I knew that you always hear me. But I said this for the benefit of the people standing, that they may believe that you are the one that has sent me.'" And 43 says, "When he said this, Jesus called out in a loud voice, 'Lazarus, come out.' And the Bible said the dead man came out, his hand and feet wrapped in strips of linen and cloth around his face. Jesus said to them, 'Take off the grave clothes and let him go.'" For just a few moments, if you would allow me, I want to preach on the topic, "Loose me and let me go." Loose me and let me go. I want to dissect, amen, some of these verses. I want to take time so that way we don't just read these words and then just fly past and we get to the fact, because everybody loves to preach that Jesus raised Lazarus from the dead. And of all the details in the story, that's the one thing that we always remember, is that Jesus goes to the tomb and he screams, "Lazarus, come out!" And Jesus comes out and the miracle is performed, that Jesus healed a dead man. And while that sounds great, while that short snippet sounds great, there's a lot of meat in this passage of scripture that I believe is important for us to dissect and to understand, because that will help us, I believe, in this next season of walking into the new year. And I believe it'll help us understand some of the things over our lives. And so in verse, I believe it was 38. That's where I started reading, right? Beautiful. Hallelujah. Christina did all that. You know, the last few months, I've gone and I've preached without having to have you pronounce a single word for me. It's been great.
So proud.
It's been great, too. Hallelujah. It's been great. I'll give you a hand clap. I'm just making a statement. I'm just making a statement. I'll give y'all a statement. No comments behind that. I'm just saying. I'm just saying. I'm not going with this. All right. But Jesus, so let's back up before we even get to 30. Let's back up, let's talk. So Jesus gets word. Jesus gets word that his friend is sick. His friend is dying. And Jesus gets this word. And when you get time, I'm going to encourage you to read all of chapter 11 here. All of chapter 11. I'm going to throw some mysteries at you today that you're going to realize, you know, what in the world. But in the beginning of chapter 11, Jesus is getting word. And he's getting word that his friend is sick. And he's hanging with some of his disciples, and one of his disciples are speaking to him, and he's saying, "You know, if he's sick, you know, he said, my friend is sleeping, and I need to go and wake him." And he said, "Well, shouldn't he wake up on his own?" And he says, "Well, maybe you're not understanding what I'm saying." He said, "My friend is dead, and the glory of God is going to be revealed. I need to go so that the glory of God can be revealed." And later down in a couple of verses down, it talks about Mary and Martha, how they approached Jesus when he first reaches the place. But before we even get there, understand this first mystery. This is one of the first things that I was confused about. The first one is he stayed where he was at for 2 additional days. Mm-hmm. Right? So understanding that first, and let's dissect the puzzle. He stays where he was for 2 days after getting word that his friend was going to die. Now, there are two towns. Christina, I may need you to help me mention the two towns. So there's town one that Jesus is currently at. And now he's got to go to the place of where his friend is. And the Bible says from this town to this town, the distance is about 2 miles. 2 miles to travel. But it also says that when he got to the tomb where Jesus was laying, or where Lazarus was laying, that Lazarus had been dead for 4 days. I'm not very good at Common Core math.
2 days. To get
there. But if he stayed where he was at for 2 days, and it's about 2 miles is what I understood the distance to travel was, how has my man been dead for 4 days?
He took his time.
Right.
The only thing that makes sense to me is that Jesus was not in a hurry. He was not in a hurry to get there.
Not too much.
If you get word that one of your best friends is sick, if you get word that somebody in your family is on their deathbed, and you look and say, well, I'll be there in a little while, and it takes you 4 days to get there, somebody in the family will have a lot of questions for you. And that's where attitudes start to rise.
There you go.
And that's where family disputes start to come in. Now, I'm not the most in shape person, and there's some other folks who are not as in shape as I am, but it should not take you 2 days to travel 2 miles.
That's right.
I understand that he got cars back then, but I still understand that we can walk 2 miles in a day.
Yeah.
Even if you want to walk a mile in the morning and a mile in the evening.
That's right.
You ain't got to be in shape to do that. But you still want to ride in the same day. But the Bible says that it took 4 days of my man being dead before Jesus even thought about getting to the place of where he was laying. But now let's talk about some of the journey, right? The Bible doesn't clearly establish, and Christine, correct me, start correcting if I'm wrong here. The Bible doesn't clearly establish his journey. It doesn't talk about a lot of the details, but one of the details that it starts to address first is it starts to talk about when he finally reaches the edge of the town. He's met by one of the sisters. And one of the sisters starts to say to Jesus, thank you for coming. I'm paraphrasing some of this. But if you had been here, my brother wouldn't have died. And she starts to have a conversation with Jesus, and Jesus is standing in the same place listening to her. And he asks about her sister, and says, go and beckon your sister and tell her that I'm alive. And so the second sister comes, and she starts her conversation off the same way. But she starts her conversation off in a different posture. One sister runs and says, Jesus, I'm so happy you're here, but if you had just been a little more, have a little more oomph, if you had gotten here a little quicker, maybe my brother wouldn't have died. And the second sister comes in, and the Bible says, falls at his feet and says the same thing, but something about the way she says it causes Jesus to now say, I gotta go. His lackadaisical, taking my time, now just sped up a little bit. Take me to where he is. And the first thing when he arrives, he looks at the tomb. And he says, take the stone away. Now you would think that everybody would be in a hurry with him. Have I messed up the course of action so far? Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. You just hold it. So, the stone is sitting here. And Jesus says, remove the stone. But what do they say first, babe? You ain't got time, I'll tell you.
It stank.
Oh, yeah. It stank. You don't want to do that. Jesus. He'd been here 4 days. Jesus, look.
You did right.
If you had came, if you had came on the first day,
this hour,
it wouldn't have been this bad. If you had come when we first sent word to you, it wouldn't have smelled like this. But since you took your time, it stank a little bit. Why would that have even had to have been a conversation? He has already said the glory of God is going to be revealed. Can I give a sidebar now? The sidebar is this. In many of our situations, and we have been praying and asking God to show up, when God shows up and now the situation is a little stinky, we want to start pointing out all the things wrong with the situation instead of the fact that Jesus is here.
Amen.
Amen.
Go ahead, bro.
We can get quick to say, but God, but God, but God. But what we miss is God is there.
Amen. Amen.
So many of us get to a place in our lives. We have asked Jesus to show up and to help us in something. God, I need you. Well, my worship leader was all in my message today. Lord, I need you. And I'm like, if she don't stop, I ain't playing with her for her day. She just sitting by herself. I ain't doing nothing else. And I'm sitting there, I'm like, she's all up in it. But we cry, Lord, I need you.
That's right.
And we can cry that thing out. And then we start to get stale and we start to get bothered in our situation, then we start focusing on the situation and we have forgot who the author and the finisher is.
Amen.
We have started focusing on, we ain't even got to the fact that he's still laying dead yet. We ain't got there yet. We haven't even made it that far. We're stuck on the stench. We haven't even reached actually being able to touch Lazarus yet. We are stuck on the smell behind the door. A smell that you can't even smell yet. Has anybody ever started looking like your situation? Anybody ever started smelling like your situation? Like, you walk into the store and people can tell you having a bad day before you even said a word. Or you walk into work and you get to work and people are like, oh, I don't know what's going on with them today, but we're going to stay with you in that class.
Yeah.
We're going to stay with you in that office today. So something ain't right in that place. You ain't even said a word.
Amen. Amen, brother.
You start to smell and look like what you're going through. I can tell you, I have been married, I've been with my wife for 16 and a half years. Praise God that we have made it 16 and a half.
Hallelujah. Amen.
Amen. But I tell you this, if I walk in the door because I know that she likes to keep herself, she likes to have her makeup on, she likes to make sure she's presentable. If I walk in the door, she's got sweats on and she ain't done nothing to herself, and I walk in the door, I know that a simple smile is going to keep her off. She ain't said a word, but I already know that something has gone wrong, and no matter what I do, hey babe, how are you? Wait a minute! You start to look and smell like what you've been through or going through. And it's interesting that we focus on that as opposed to you are in the presence of Jesus. And he has already said, now take me to where he is. He doesn't care about the smell. He doesn't care about the situation. He just says, take me to the center of the problem so that I can step in and interrupt the rest of the plan. And so, now let's move on a little further.
roll the stone away. The stone gets rolled away. Do you know that Jesus never comments on the stench when the stone gets rolled away? Thank God that he looks beyond my faults.
Amen.
Thank God he looks beyond what it looks like. And he speaks to Lazarus, come out. The significance of him speaking the words, come out. Hear me well. Jesus is not going to walk into the darkness. But Jesus has called Lazarus out to his light.
Amen. Go ahead.
Jesus is not going to go and hang out in your mess. But he will pull you out of your mess.
Right, bro.
And to hang with him. And so, now I've hit on that. That was already a hard bullet by itself, right? So I ain't got to stay on that one long. You already caught that concept. That he's already called him out. So now that he's called him out, as we move down to probably around 41, it starts to talk about Lazarus comes out, maybe it's 43. He comes out and he's still bound hand and foot. What's interesting to me is Jesus will call us out of something. Jesus will prick the heart. You will give your heart to Jesus. The heart changes, but the outward is still bound. And this is the foundation of where I wanted to get to take us into this next year. In order, because we have learned how to declare things over ourselves, we have learned to, because we've heard people say that if I start speaking over myself, that maybe it'll change situations and stuff. But hear me on this. Before you start speaking the positive, let's address some of the negative. The mess that attached itself to you last year, that wasn't supposed to be attached, you need to address that first. Speak to it. Tell the demons they have to go. Speak to the chains. Tell them they have to fall. That mess that attached itself to you last year needs to free itself. You've heard me preach a 3-week series on At the Table, using the foundation of Scripture from Psalms 23. God cannot fill your cup if it's already full.
Amen.
One of the things that we had to endure last year was moving 3 times. And do you know, when we moved out of the first house, we took so much crap to the dump. When we moved out of the second house and we were only there 3 months, do you know what we did again?
Went to the dump.
More to the dump. There's no way God can bless us with more until we get rid of. What if I kept the same furniture from my last house and from the rental house and said, but God has blessed me with more furniture for this house? The house is cluttered again. You can't enjoy the new because you're still enduring the old.
Pastor, this is getting deep quick.
You cannot embrace what the next 365 has to offer if you're still cluttered with what the last 365 offered.
Go ahead, bro. That's right.
We have to first speak to the old, loose me and let me go so that I can embrace the blessings of what he has for me this year. Now, I'm not saying that every day is going to be sunshine. But what I can tell you, there were 3 Hebrew boys, right, that were thrown in the fire. And it's interesting that the same setup was there. They were bound hand and foot. Correct me, if Bible scholar, if I'm wrong somewhere, George. They were bound hand and foot. They were thrown in to the fire. The fire was turned up 10 times hotter, so hot that the people who threw them in the fire died from the heat. But those who threw them in, expecting that they were going to see ash, and expecting that they were going to see torment, and expecting that they were going to see defeat, they lost the bet. Why did they lose the bet? They looked in, and what was bound was no longer bound. What was hindered was no longer hindered. Why? Because the people who were thrown in stopped focusing on the situation and focused on who was in the situation with them.
Amen.
There's a fourth set of feet running around in there. But check this, George, just so I can make sure I stay aligned with where I'm supposed to be at. See, they were talking about stenches too, right? What happened to their stench?
They didn't smell like
what it should have smelled like.
That's right.
It didn't smell like what they said it don't smell like. See, if you've been around a fire, you're supposed to smell like fire.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
If you've been around death, it's supposed to smell like death.
Mm-hmm.
If you've been around divorce, it's supposed to look like divorce, smell like divorce. If you've been around defeat, it's supposed to look and smell like defeat. If you've been around, come on, give me something else. Depression is supposed to look and smell like depression. Mm. If you've been around cancer, you're supposed to have signs that are evident that look and smell like cancer. But can I tell you that when God does something, you won't look like what you've been through. You won't act like what you've been through. But instead, you will have a different praise, which Paul was talking about last Sunday. You will have a different shout. You will have a different voice. You will have a different outlook on life.
Amen. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Because God showed up and did it. He told them the glory of God will be revealed. But one of the things that he never said was, he didn't say how he was going to do it. He didn't say how the glory was going to show up and do it. He just said, the glory shall be revealed.
That's right.
Take me to the problem. So as I speak to you today, I want to encourage you that you must first release some stuff. Start speaking for some new stuff. God's going to show up in your current situation. And when he shows up, he is telling you the glory of God is going to be revealed. He may not say when, he may not say how, he may not say at what hour, but what he is saying is he's going to do it.
Amen.
Amen.
He's going to do it. Loose us from what we've been through. And let me go so that I can walk into the fullness of God. Amen.
Amen.
And everything he has for me.
There's some new stuff that awaits us this year. Man, I don't know what tomorrow holds. You heard me say this over and over. But I know who holds it. I don't know what this year holds, but I know who holds it.
Amen.
So there's no point in me focusing on day to day when I can focus on the one who holds it. So this year I want to encourage you to change your focus. Change your focus. Is that all right?
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Thank you, Father. Still came out different than last week, but I asked God to season this word. We use the same passage of scripture, but I asked him to season it, to change it, customize for our church. He did just that. Thankful, amen. So, as we march into today's the 14th day of the new year, which means there should be 350, and it's still 2 days, but it's a leap year. 352 days left in the year. As you march for the next 352, I don't know, in the last 14 of you have released everything. You know, you never hear me talk about resolutions because that stuff, man, is, we lie to ourselves every day. We get good at that too. I've been so good at lying to myself over the years. I ain't yet not one. I ain't yet not one. But I tell you, I'm choosing today to not focus on any of the mess that I went through last year. I'm choosing not to focus on any of the
I mean, and I'm not talking, man, just one day of bad last year, 2 days of bad, man, but, man, there was some good that happened last year. God kept me all 365 days last year. There was some positive. God did some miraculous things. He blessed us with a new house last year. He blessed us with a lot of stuff last year. But I believe it's important for us still to shed some old. He can't bless you internally with new until you get rid of some. But he can't bless you externally either until you get rid of some.
That's right.
What's the point of having 6 cars in the driveway? And it's just you. It's just you. What's the purpose of having 3 houses? It's just you. Closets filled with 80 pairs of pants and stuff. You like, man, that's one of the things last year that embarrassed me. Do you know we found bags of clothes at the bottom of our closet from when I was in high school?
Jesus? Oh, sorry.
Paul. This is embarrassing. Paul, don't laugh yet. This is going to get real good. I wrestled in high school.
I was getting ready to say that.
Paul. There was a singlet that had a big M.
Oh, no.
That looked like it could have fit my dog. Why do I still have that stuff? That's a visual image I want you to keep for a while. You are welcome. You're on Facebook, I'm sorry. I should pass it a new light. Hey, we don't need an extra. But y'all, get rid of some stuff. Why? But I bet now you're thinking, what do I have ripped off 30 years ago?
Yeah.
Really, thank you, God.
Man, let's shake some stuff so God can bless this for you. Amen.
Amen.
Come on, stand to me. God is good, man.
Yes, he is.
Those of you guys, this is your first time. This is how we are, Father. Stop laughing. You know how to laugh a little bit?
That's right.
Good time. God, really make the heart real. Does something different. Amen. You'll hold on to it.
Amen.
But, let me first offer a salvation call for those who are on Facebook and those who are in this room. Let me give the salvation call. Every eye closed. I like the simplicity of what Paul did last week. And just simply just say, man, if you want to give your heart to God, it's really easy. It ain't no like show, anything crazy. All you're going to say, Lord, I'm a sinner, I messed up. I'm sorry. Save me. I believe you can do it. Save me. You died on the cross for me. Save me. And I believe if you pray those simple prayers, I believe there's a God today who has saved you. So today you can make that declaration. If you'll just pray that prayer and just say, Lord Jesus, save me. Save me. Believe you died for me and rose for me.
Up there. Carla Gallup, she's asking us to pray for her uncle. He had a stroke on Friday.
He got what?
He had a stroke on Friday.
Father, in Jesus' name, God, we pray that you would intercede even now.
Yes.
God, isn't it the word said earlier that Jesus waited 2 days and then he showed up? God, it was a stroke that happened on Friday. And I still believe, God, that you can go right where he's at.
Yes, God.
And that you can visit where he's at. And God, that you can make everything all right. So God, intervene now. God, cause every blood vessel to open and flow like it's supposed to. God, cause every vein to work like it's supposed to. God, we thank you now, God, for even restoring, God, mobility to the limbs. God, we declare it now done in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. We don't know him by name, but we call him healed in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you for reaching out to us. God bless you. Amen.